Hey guys, Commander Davis here. We're gonna do a little bit of a different video today. I have done all except for, I believe, the Alchemist and Virtuoso for my guide videos. Today I'm gonna go actually over what weapons you guys should be looking out for, as well as some items. Since we're already in here. First things first, we're gonna go ahead with the one-handers bolt. We're just gonna go ahead and just show everything on the right hand side here what it all looks like. Item level 27, extremely rare, same with the brand and rhyme. If you guys have any questions at all, don't hesitate to go ahead and ask it down in the comment section, as well as I will leave a link to my Discord down in the description, so you guys can go ahead and send me any messages there if you have any questions about anything. Hackon's Honor, self-explanatory, 5 seconds of Walking Fortress, 10% chance. 10% chance to use Unbowed. Basically, Unbowed, I'm going to explain this because not many of the newer players know what Unbowed is. Unbowed is kind of like Livid. Basically, it's just going to give you extra guard, really. Valus Atridium, great sword if you don't have any of the ones above. Revered Defender Longsword. In order to get the Valus Atridium, as well as any of the other quote-unquote dwarven weapons, I'm going to call them, they came with a dwarven DLC in the campaign. You have to get the blue version in order to get to the purple version. So in order to get the Valus Atridium, you have to have the blue version in your current inventory. So just keep that in mind. So if you see anything called Revered Defender Longsword, keep it to get to the Valus Atridium. Raider Axe, a great axe here. Longsword of the Dragon, a decent starter one. I just kept this Ritual Breaker because I needed my mace kills and I haven't gotten rid of it yet. Alright, on to the two-handers. Hackon's Valor, 10% chance to grant 12 seconds of Horn of Valor, 10% chance to grant 5 seconds of Blessed Blades. For all the Hackons, I'm going to go over what each ability is, even though you guys can read it. I just feel like going over it, why not, you know. Stonebreaker is another Dwarven weapon with the Revered Defender Maul here, as you see underneath it. Edgewise is a decent one. It gives you a 49 or plus 49 armor, as well as 14 constitution and a chance to taunt all the enemies within 8 meters of you for 4 seconds. A decent one. I only used it a couple times. I actually scrapped it and then re-got it as I started to collect more weapons so I could do a video like this in the future. Greatsword of the Dragon, honestly, not the greatest in my opinion. It's great if it's the best one you have. Maul of the Dragon's a lot better because it comes with 11% heal on kill, as well as you can put a haft and a pommel on it compared to the Greatsword, where you can't put anything but a rune. Skywatcher's Cleaver, definitely a good one. Right now, this one I have nothing on it, I don't use it anymore. But this is what I used to use on it, if in case anybody was curious. Just 36% critical damage. However, if you are under the 200 cunning or the 100% crit chance, I would recommend putting crit chance on it. Sylvan Blade, I just kept it just because it's a decent one. Pull of the chance to cast Pull of the Abyss on a hit. Could come in handy with the Reaver. Who knows? Spoon of the Spoon, I will always keep this one. This is a fun one. It's literally a spoon, and it's a... Now let me go ahead and up on the Reavers here. There we go. I'll go ahead and equip it, and you'll see. It's literally a spoon. See, a spoon. It explodes on kill. Decent maul. Let me go back and put my Hackon back on. Hackon's Wisdom. It comes stock with everything except for the willpower and the heal on kill. 10% abilities cost 10% less mana on kill plus 30 to magic for 10 seconds. I honestly have no idea if that stacks per kill. That'd be overpowered if it did. I'm going to assume it doesn't until I hear or see otherwise. I'm going to assume it does not stack. Asana Song is another Dwarven weapon. It does 10% chance to cast Chain Lightning at 100% weapon damage. And the blue version of that is down here, the Lyrium Infused Staff. Then you got the Kingfisher. Do I have an empty one? I do. So I have, where is it? I have the, this is what the stock one looks like. 48 barrier damage, 11% healing kill with a chance to cast Pull of the Abyss. I have used additional healing kill, which upped it to 28, as well as you see right here, more crit chance, more crit damage, all that. However, I don't use those anymore. I use the Hack-On. Before I used the Hack-On, I used this one down here, the Scepter of Razzicul, very, very powerful. Heart of Pride, Permashock, all enemies nearby are constantly shocked, which equals more electricity or more elemental damage. There we go. Apologies. So if they're close to you and they're shocked, they'll do you'll do more elemental damage, as well as a 50% bonus resistance to electricity and a 50% attack speed. Heart of Despair, Permafrost, all nearby enemies are constantly chilled. It grants 50% bonus resistance to cold and physical damage. Scepter of Razzicul, the only good fire staff in the game. Not really much out there, and I'm going to butcher this next name. Yavanalis, I believe. It is the only guard on hit staff. This is what, like I said, came stock on it, and this is what I have on. I have 11% attack and 9% heal on kill with 5 willpower. Blizzard's Path is an alright one. I don't use it, but I may use it in the future just for shits and giggles. Alright, on to the daggers. The daggers are the fun ones. This is the Assassin Blade, as I call it, even though it's called the Bosun Blade. Cowardice. All attacks deal 500% from behind the target, but only 10% from the front. This is great for the Assassin and the Assassin only, honestly. It hits like a truck. The Hack-Ons, basically exactly the same. I just added Armor Pen on one of them. They give you, oh, they do increase your stamina. Okay, I haven't looked at the abilities in a while. Increase maximum stamina by 20. On kill grants 35 stamina. They both stack, so you can have an additional 40 stamina and additional 70 stamina on kill. Now we get into the fun daggers. Silencer, another Dwarven weapon. 10% chance to use Hidden Blades on a hit with 5 added hits. Exactly the same one, if you notice here, is a 171 damage and the other is a 169. You're going to want to put whatever your highest damage number is in your main hand. If you guys need help with a video on that, I will be... I can for sure help you guys with that, because I was kind of confused on how to put certain daggers in certain hands. So let me know, guys, down below if you guys would like a video on that or not. Stonestalker Blade is the blue version to the silencer. Village costs 10% less mana or stamina. It's honestly not the greatest blade unless it's your highest damaging blade. You definitely want to get the silencer. Now, the best dagger in the game, the Bloody Bargain. It comes stock with 17% healing kill, the highest you can ever get with, is it 17 or is it 14? I think it's 14. I could be wrong because I think I added a tad bit. Either way, it comes with the highest stock healing kill you can get with the Bloody Bargain. With the daggers. Apologies. It's 6 a.m. when I'm recording this, so a tad bit tired. Rampage, on kill, movement, and attack speed increases by 10% for 30 seconds, stacks up to 5 times. That is what makes this dagger so amazing. Savage Thorn. I don't ever really use this one or the Dagger of the Dragon, but here's the stats on them. You gain 5 guard on hit. Audacity is a alright one if you want to pair it with your duelist to get the explosion on kill. But really nothing too fancy. The best thing I can see you can add is a crit damage or crit chance on it. Other than that, it's really not the greatest dagger. But if it's the best one you have. And then on to the bows. Angel's Gift is a item level 27, 48% attack, 41% crit chance, which is kind of ironic because it helps the lower levels. However, it's a harder bow to come by. Electricity Enchanted. All attacks deal electricity damage and have a chance on hit to paralyze the target. Also, what they do not tell you is it shoots two arrows in straight succession instead of one. So you'll basically be doing double damage with this bow. Hakon's Wrath. It comes stock with everything except for the 36% heal on kill. 30% damage bonus if not being hit for 5 seconds. Weapon fires 3 shots when attacking. The next two on our list are the Dwarven Weapons, as I keep calling them. Hesperdin's Bane is an explosion bow for 150% weapon damage. Lyrium Reinforced Longbow is, again, the same thing, just a little bit weaker with 100% weapon damage. Bow of the Dragon, decent starter bow, 8% heal on kill. Now, the Heartstring Bow is where it's at. It comes stock with 22% heal on kill. In my opinion, it's the second best bow in the game, first best bow if you don't have the hack on. Because you can add up to 50% critical chance with it. If you add the thick longbow grip, and instead of doing the critical damage there, if you add great bear hide to it, instead of the whatever I had on it, you can get an additional 42% crit chance, which will equal the 50%. As well as on hit heal 1% of maximum health. Really great bow here, the heartstring. Bow of the Artifice is alright. A decent bow. On hit chance to cast or chance that elemental mind spawn around my target. Jeez, I can't even read. As well as a 42% critical chance on it. Another decent starter bow. I don't know why I have two of them, but Longshot was one of my first bows I got. I liked it because of the flanking damage as well as a 30% bonus damage if not being hit for 5 seconds. Longbow of the Griffin is basically there's two versions of it. There is a level 10 version and a level 21 version. I got rid of my level 10 one after I got my level 21. But it's basically a lower version of the Hakon. It shoots 3 arrows when attacking, 42% attack, and 11 armor pen. I can never pronounce this one, but this is basically the Trepanner's Quiddle, I believe. We'll just go with that. Okay. It's basically the Tesbidin's Bane, very, very small. It's 75% weapon damage. I'm actually going to scrap it. There's really no reason to keep it, unless, again, it's your best bow you got. Now up to the field. The Knight's Second is another item level 27. Guardian Spirit blocks 1 melee attack every 30 seconds. So you guys know, if you guys ever play the Legionnaire, with the Counter-Strike, when it has the Revenant pop up and it knocks everybody down, that's what that Guardian Spirit is. The next two are the Dwarven Weapons, the two best shields in the game in my opinion, or one of the best shields in the game here. 10% chance to grant 5 seconds of Walk in Fortress. Revered Defender Bulwark, 5% chance to cast Unbowed on the hit. It's alright. I would definitely just keep it in your inventory unless it's your highest one, then equip it. If not, equip whatever's your highest, whether it's like the Stinking Cheater down here with your armor higher. But definitely it's to know if you can get it, equip it, because that Walking Fortress, if you have the Legionnaire and you have Walking Fortress upgraded, even if you don't run Walking Fortress, it will upgrade it on your shield too. Very, very, very powerful. Next is the Stinking Cheater. On chance, or on hit, chance to spawn a Toxic Cloud at a target location. As well as it does do damage. Not many people realize it does do damage. It doesn't pop up the damage numbers. You just have to lock in or lock onto the target to see it doing damage. Shield of the Dragon's a decent one. Starter one, really nothing too fancy. Shield of the Emperor now is the second best shield in the game. I consider it the best if you have the stats, but if you're a beginner and starter, I would run the Istanil for a while. The Shield of the Emperor heals 15% of damage taken over 10 seconds with a 7% heal bonus. So basically, if I'm standing there with my Templar or Legionnaire, and I'm say I'm Red Bar, right, and I pop Warcry with my Legionnaire, if I start taking damage, even though technically I'm not taking physical damage, I'm still taking damage, I'll heal. Or if I pop Walking Fortress, I'm taking damage, I'll still heal myself. 15% of the damage over 10 seconds. Very overpowered. Mage Hunter, only reason I keep this one is because of the 3-guard. Ante gain 3-guard. Other than that, I really wouldn't too much stock into it. Winter's Breath is an amazing shield for people that can take damage. Like, I run it on my Legionnaire because of the Berserk. 50% bonus damage, but you take 50% more damage, so it's like a win-lose kind of. If you can heal up all the damage you're taking, there's really no loss to it. Reason I kept the Aegis or the Order is it's a weaker version of the Shield of the Emperor. It's the same bonus, but it's a weaker, it's half the, actually less than half of the armor rating. So, alright, that is it for the weapons. We're going to go over the accessories, because I know a lot of people have been asking about that. I know I only have it on 15 out of my characters. It should be on a 16. Weird. Alright, we're going to go over the belts first. These three, you're going to want to keep. Honestly, I don't really use a winter pack, but it's nice just to keep all three of them. Kind of like a collector of sort. Belt of Urgency as well. Actually, let me show you what these guys do. Fire-based abilities are much, much more powerful at the cost of a large amount of your health. Let's put it into perspective. If you have 180 constitution, we're just going to throw a number out here for constitution or for like health-wise. Say you had 2,000 health. If you put this pact bond on, you drop down to 300 health. It drastically reduces your health, but it increases drastically your elemental based attacks. Really the only two I use are the Storm and the Inferno on the Cerberus. Not much lately, but Storm on the Arcane for sure. Belt of Urgency, the wearer of this belt gains a large boost to attack speed when below 50% health. This is wonderful with the Reaver, because you know how she likes to, the lower your health is, the more damage you do, you can actually increase it more by doing more damage by attacking faster while doing more physical damage because you're lower on health. Just keep an eye on your health bar. Belt of Health, self-explanatory, 200 extra health. Belt of Staggering, this is what I run on all my characters, as you can see for the most part right now. 10% chance to stagger on being hit. So if I'm just standing there attacking and an enemy comes up behind me and attacks me, they have a 10% chance of getting staggered, which means they'll just hit me and they'll just sit there with their head down, or they'll be kind of like kind of stunned, but it's not stunned. It's sort of stunned, but it doesn't show up saying staggered. It doesn't show up saying stunned. You'll know when they get staggered. They won't be able to attack you. It is primed for a detonator though, so like if they stagger, you can do like a Mind Blast or a Immolate or a Stone Fist and do combos off yourself. Well, that is it for the belts. Let's head over to the rings. These are kind of interesting for me. I don't know why I keep the Superb Ring of Attack, but I have it. Mainly I just keep 2 crit damage rings, 2 life drain rings, a barrier ring for when I run Keeper, which I very rarely run Keeper anymore. Cool Beast ring for my Virtuoso. I'm actually going to get rid of the Crushing Leap. I don't use it on my Avar. Dragon Rage Ring, I run on my Reaver because, well, why not? As long as you got Devour and Rampage, you'll be good. Infinity Barrage, don't know why I keep that. Don't know why I keep that one. I should have cleaned these up before I made this video. Fade Cloak Ring, don't know why I keep that. Firestorm, Hot Legs, Almost Strike, you know what? Let's see. Stone Fist, don't need it. Warcry, alright. Let me go ahead and salvage all these real quick. Oop, wrong button, guys. Apologies. Should have done this before I started recording. Alright, we were at... There we go. Dragon Rage, Lady's Wrath for the Avar, and then Walking Bomb for the Necromancer. Really, that's about the only rings I would recommend keeping. Doesn't mean that they're the only good ones. They're really good. Because, like, think about it. Necromancer, Walking Bomb, easy. You're really only using that ability. Lady's Wrath, Avar, really only using that ability. Dragon Rage, only using that ability. And with the other two, Cool Beats, that's only all I use on my Burt. So let's go over to the amulets now. Now, this one is the rarest item in the game. The wearer of this amulet suffers no physical effects in combat, meaning I don't get knocked down. There's three or four attacks in the game that will actually knock me down with this amulet. So if you ever see anyone just standing still and not getting knocked down to a shield or a despair demon or a dragon ball, that's probably why they're not getting knocked down. They probably have this ability or this amulet on. Apologies. Amulet of Renewal. I ran this one once I got this one. Why do I have it on my duelist? That's strange. Sorry guys. That's probably why it's, yeah. So I ran this on all of my characters except for the Cerberus until I got my Amulet of Physical Immunity, because it drastically changes your regeneration of mana and stamina a lot. You'll notice the difference when you take it off. Superb Amulet of Aggression. I don't even know why I keep this stupid thing. Sometimes it doesn't even flipping work. You put this on and they still run away from you. But it's supposed to give you a large amount of threat. Master Stamina Amulet. People don't realize that this is out here. But it's higher than the Superb. 60 stamina instead of 50. I got rid of my Superb stamina, but I would keep it if I had it. Superb Amulet of Dexterity and Superb Cooldown Amulet. That is really all I keep. Alright guys, so we're back. After making this video, I forgot to show you guys this weapon, the Crescent Shadow. In order to get this weapon, you have to get all of the 27s here. All the Hack-Ons. All the purple 26s here. Except for the Kingfisher. The Silencer here, the Stonebreaker, Hesbitten's Bane, Velas, Atridium, all that. All the blue versions of them. As well as... Where is it? As well as the Amulet of Physical Immunity. So this weapon is very powerful. Unfortunately, it's only for one-handers. It gives basically the same thing as the Hack-On sword, sorta. Like, you get the 100 critical damage, everything else just higher damage with a 243, as well as a Crescent Blade. What that does is it shoots out three ice balls that I honestly have no idea how much damage they do. My lowest I saw hit for was like 30,000. The highest I seen it hit for was like 80,000 to 90,000. So that is why this weapon is so hard to get and so powerful. So I apologize for forgetting about it. But I will have it. It will have its own chapter in here. So if you guys are curious, it'll probably be at the very end of it. So, but yeah, guys, thanks for watching. Hope you guys all enjoyed this video. Links will be in the description to all my social media accounts. Hope you all have a wonderful day.